Good evening. We're continuing our series on an overview of Job, actually all the wisdom literature, but we're in the book of Job, and I have chapters 22 through 28 tonight. It's a challenge, as we all know. You guys that have gone before know what a chore it is to try to reduce this material down and pull out some salient points and make the lesson beneficial to everybody. And that's our desire tonight. We've covered the first two cycles of discourse between Job and his friends who came to comfort him, and Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. And in tonight's class, we begin the third and final discourse between Job and those individuals. As we said, we bring out some of the major points that are contained in these chapters. In cycle one, the discourse there, Job's visitors implied that he was a sinner and made an appeal for him to repent of his sins that he had committed. In cycle two, they offered Job no opportunity for repentance, but they insinuated that he was guilty and emphasized the fate of wicked people in that discourse. In this third cycle, the attacks upon Job, to me, are shameful. Absolutely shameful for him to have to endure what he's going to endure. And friends. With friends like that, you don't need very many enemies. The attacks on Job become so much more aggressive, vicious, uncaring, if you will. So they're going to make some direct accusations that Job is guilty of specific sins. And Eliphaz is going to, again, call for Job to repent and turn back to God. Most of the criticisms that will be raised in these discourses are not new, but the intensity of the attack on Job certainly is. So some of these arguments have already been made in previous discourses in this book. Job withstood the first two rounds of debate without compromising his position in the matters that were discussed. The main topic here seems to be that the friends insist that the wicked always suffer. And Job denies that he was an overt or deliberate transgressor of the will of God. In studying this great book of the Bible, we have the advantage of the complete revelation of God, so we can look forward in time, which Job could not do. And so we'll pull out some various verses from elsewhere in the Bible that shed light on some of these topics. I hope you can see that. I tried to make it as big as I could and still get it on the slide. Chapter 22, we've listed sort of a theme or a topic, if you will, from each chapter. Your wickedness is great. Job's response comes in chapters 23 and 24. Where is God? And complaints of violence on the earth. Bildad will speak in chapter 25, how can man be made righteous? Job's response will come again in chapter 26 and will continue, if you will, in 27 and 28. They'll talk about man's frailty and God's majesty, and Job's going to once again defend his cause and his circumstances. And then Job's going to end with a discourse on wisdom, and I hope we have time to get to it, because to me, that is a glorious portion of the Bible and of this book in particular. In chapter 22, Eliphaz begins his last speech, if you will, by making three false accusations against Job. These accusations are, as we said, some repetitions of the two previous encounters with Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. As you can see on this slide, they're saying that Job is being punished because he's a sinful man in chapter 22. Job is hiding his sins. Another contention that they're making, verses 12 through 20. And Job must confess his sins and repent in order to mitigate the suffering that he is enduring as the chapter ends. So without further comment on that, we need to move along. But Eliphaz is saying that since God has sent such a terrible judgment on Job, he must be guilty of great and endless sins, if you will. Look at verse 5 of Job chapter 22. It says there, "Is not your wickedness great and your iniquity without end?" That's a big statement to make against anyone, but it's really hurtful to say something like that about Job. Eliphaz holds this position, although he has no evidence for holding that position. This is so familiar to us today. When you cannot win an argument with someone by addressing issues directly, you attack your opponent. That's what's happening here. The idea that God punishes all sinners in this life was still around in New Testament times, if you think about it. Even Jesus' closest followers had a problem with it. And it's still with us today. Remember the blind man in John chapter 9? Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, saying, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither. Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him." So some people think today, when something unfortunate happens to another person, they've got to have committed some kind of terrible sin in order for that to happen to them. The sins that are enumerated by Eliphaz, the first one, pride, in chapter 22, verses 2 and 3. We should remember that Job's character and his conduct are important to God. They're very important to God. His way of life was a profitable way, and it was a life that brought pleasure to God. Because remember, God was using Job to silence Satan. And so that's something that we need to understand when we look at this great situation that Job finds himself in. He said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" So he was using Job as an example of what is good and right. The Bible has ample evidence that God derives pleasure in the righteousness of men, and a couple of verses are on the slide Finally then, brethren, we urge and exhort in the Lord Jesus that you should abound more and more, just as you received from us how you ought to walk and to please God. So there's a way that man can live and please God. They can actually bring pleasure to God by the way they live. You and I can do that if we follow his way. Psalm 35 and 27, let them shout for joy and be glad who favor my righteous cause. And let them say continually, let the Lord be magnified who has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. And so we see there a couple of verses in that regard. Another verse, Psalm 147, 11, the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him and in those who hope in his mercy. In Psalm 37, 23, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. God delights in a man who follows his way. Another sin in this chapter, covetousness, he's accused of in verse 6. He says, for you have exacted pledges of your brothers for nothing and stripped the naked of their clothing. Eliphaz considered Job to be a greedy man who gained wealth by abusing other people. He believes that Job used his power and his position to intimidate and take advantage of other people. He was accused of taking security from others when there was no need to do so. He was accused of taking the very shirt off their back, if you will, as a pledge for a loan or something like that. The lack of mercy and compassion was talked about in verses 7 through 9. Job was accused of giving no water to the weary who were thirsty, withholding bread from the hungry. Eliphaz accused Job of sending widows away empty-handed. Job was accused of sending the orphans away with nothing when they sought his help. God's always been concerned about the orphan and the widow and the poor. He's always been concerned about them. And I put a verse there that is very familiar to all of us, that he still commands us to take care of the orphans and the widows, the fatherless, the King James said, and the widows in their afflictions. Eliphaz says that it was because of these specific sins that there were snares around Job. He was troubled by fear and dread, darkness and an abundance of water. Trouble had overwhelmed Job, inundated him like the waters of a flood. His misfortunes are figuratively and metaphorically referred to as blinding darkness and destructive floods. He must feel like David when David wrote this psalm. Psalm 69, 1 through 3. Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in deep mire where there is no standing. I have come into deep waters where the floods overflow me. I'm weary with my crying. My throat is dry. My eyes fail while I wait for my God. I ran across these seven words at the bottom of this slide in the middle of a paragraph in a commentary written by Francis Anderson. You know how sometimes you read a book and something jumps off the page? Those seven words jumped off the page. And I've thought about them every day since I read that. You know why? Because our faith needs to keep a dry skin in water. When floods of trouble come to us, we need to maintain our faith. Now remember something Dennis Washington said in that text message, that last one. I thought so much about it, I wrote it down. Dennis said, never once have I felt like I was drowning in fear. Do you know why he said that? Faith keeps a dry skin in water. He would not allow his faith to be destroyed by his circumstances and the trouble and his afflictions that had come upon him in this life. Well, it's much like Job. It's much like Job. We have examples all around us in this congregation of a faith like Job's that doesn't fail men when trouble comes and difficulty comes upon us. May we have that kind of faith. May we make the same request as the apostles made of Jesus in Luke 17 and verse 5 when they said, increase our faith. That's a lesson for us tonight. Keep your faith in such a way that it has a dry skin in water. The other accusation was that Job was hiding his sins, verses 12 through 20. Eliphaz, as we said, is making these charges up. There's no basis for them. He's just making these things up. Now he's putting words in Job's mouth. Job never said these things, but he's putting words in his mouth. He's implying that Job is in the old way of wicked men. And there are a lot of references in here. But God resides in the height of heaven. How can he know what's going on earth? He can't see what's happening through the deep darkness and clouds that cover him.
And that's why they were in the wrong at the very end of the book. This is the moment.
Absolutely. So now he's, we used to say about some preachers, I don't know about ours here but that I've ever said it, but they quit preaching and go to meddling. But that's sort of what we have here. He's making things up, accusing Job of things without any evidence of such. And so... here's a point that really struck home to me. He's virtually charging Job with denying the omnipotence, the omniscience, and the omnipresence of God right here in these verses. Job never would do such a thing. In verses 15 through 20, Eliphaz implies that Job is in the old way. Which wicked men have trod. The first thing I thought about when I read verses 16 and 17 in chapter 22 was the flood in Noah's day. That's a terrible thing to say to Job when we recall that the thought of men were only continually evil in the days of Noah. And to accuse, if that's what they had in mind, they were accusing Job of something very grievous. Most believe it's a reference to the great deluge, but it could apply to wicked people in general. The man who built his house upon a rock, that's a good indication here. You'd have a firm foundation if you do that. But if you don't, if you build your house on the sand, rains will descend, your house will fall, is what the New Testament says in Matthew 7. Can a man hide himself or his sins from God? Jeremiah 23 says, am I a God near at hand, says the Lord, and not a God afar off? Can anyone hide himself in secret places so I shall not see him, says the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, says the Lord? There's no place you can go to hide from God. So the contention that Eliphaz makes is false. Hebrews 4 and 13, and there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. If you want another verse, one of the best on this topic that fits Job, we're not going to read it, but Psalm 139, verses 7 through 12. Wow, really drives this point home. What's happening in this chapter is Eliphaz is going to say some good things. He's going to say some things that sounds like Richard in the pulpit at the end here, where he's encouraging repentance. He's encouraging people to Job to return to God, and yet it's the right prescription being given to the wrong patient. None of it was needful to be given to Job. He's telling him to acquaint yourself with him. He was acquainted with God. Receive instructions from his mouth. He had done that. He laid up his words in his heart. Return to the Almighty. He had not departed from the Almighty. Remove iniquity from your tents. Job was doing his best to live a godly life. Renounce your trust in material things, your gold and silver. He had no trust in those things. He'd lost it all. He lost it all. And so we see there that the right prescriptions given to the wrong patient, the comments sound like they could be preached from a pulpit somewhere in the Lord's church in our time in that section. If Job will repent and return to God, here are five blessings that Eliphaz has promised. He'll be, God will be Job's new treasure. Job's prayers will be heard. His decrees, desires will be established with God. When men are cast down, Job would be able to lift a humble person up. Job had the power to deliver others as well. He would have that power if he would but repent. And Job had done these things. Chapter 23. Job's response, where is God? Job's going to respond, but basically he ignores most of what Eliphaz has said in chapter 22. And this is the seventh discourse of Job in this book. He restates his desire to speak with God. His friends have been no help to him. They've been a frustration to him. Job says that his complaint is bitter, but his punishment and suffering are more grievous than even his complaint can express. The most pressing problem Job has is that he cannot find God. He can't find God. If he could only find God, he would approach his judgment seat, argue his case, listen to God's explanation, and the Lord would hear him. He further believes that in his innocence, he would be vindicated by God. So somebody said, it's like God is playing a game of cosmic hide and seek with Job. There's a reason for it. Job says he's looked to the north, the south, the east, the west, before, behind, but he's not been able to find God. As Christians, we may feel sometimes that we cannot find God either, especially when we're in a time of severe distress. But we have assurance that God loves us. He's always there for his people. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Hebrews 4:16. 1 John 5, verse 14 and 15. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. God cares about us. We can communicate with him at any time of day or night through our mediator, Christ Jesus. We have a loving God that may not always give us what we want, but he'll do one thing. He'll give us what we need every time. He'll give us what we need. In verse 10 of chapter 23, Job believes that he's valuable to God, and that when God is through testing him, he will come forth as gold. I believe Jeffrey mentioned that verse in his lesson previously. Job believes that it's that way because he knows he's kept the way of God and not turned aside from God's way. Love what he says in verse 12. I've not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Would that we, everyone in this class tonight, would have that attitude toward the Word of God. That it would mean more to us than our necessary food. For so, God's Word was Job's treasure, not his own personal riches. In the remainder of chapter 23, Job discusses the unchangeable nature and the sovereignty of God. When God says something, it's going to come to pass. In the attack of Babylon against Jerusalem in Ezekiel 24:14, the Bible says, I, the Lord, have spoken it, it shall come to pass, and I will do it. And power of God and his determination for things to happen. We don't need to question or demand that God answer why he's doing anything. We need to accept his will. That's where faith and trust comes into our relationship with God. We trust him to do what's right every time, and we should. Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. To ask is one thing. Yeah, we can ask, and probably at some time in your life you've asked God, why does this have to happen? Please, don't let this happen. And it's all right to ask, but to demand that God do anything, he's sovereign. He's sovereign. He has the right to do what he wants to do. And he has the ability to do what he wants to do. Job can't fully understand what's been appointed for him. The uncertainty of God's actions in his life causes him to be in fear. He wonders why he didn't die before having to endure this ordeal that he's going through. Chapter 24. We'll go through these hurriedly. Unfortunately, we have to. We only have a few minutes left. The first verse in this chapter says, why are not the times of judgment kept by the Almighty? And why do those who know him never see his days? Roy Zuck wrote a commentary, and he said he wondered why God did not set aside specific times for judging so that those who trusted him could see him at work on those days. Why God didn't set specific times periodically to judge evil, wicked men, and so that the righteous could see him doing those things and carrying out his sovereign will against wickedness. In verses 1 through 17 of chapter 24, Job questions why the wicked often sin with impunity. And there's a list of sinful activity in these verses that involve the oppression of the poor and the helpless, forcing them to live off the land and suffer and struggle for survival. And there's other things. I won't go into this, but removing boundary lines. We know, we read this list, and we know that God has made rulings in almost every one of these cases of what his will is, and yet men are guilty of doing these things and not suffering any particular kind of immediate punishment for them. In the end, the wicked are going to receive what they have coming. Punishment comes in God's own time. I'm not even going to read these verses, but we know that everyone will appear before the judgment seat of Christ to receive the things done in the body, whether good or bad. It's coming. The day is coming. Whether a evil person in this life receives what we might call his just deserts, whether he receives any adverse circumstances, that's up to God. But we know that there's coming a time when he will. Chapter 25, Bildad is speaking. Shortest verse, chapter in this book of the Bible. 6 verses, I believe it is. He talks about God's power being inherent in his nature, about him being sovereign. Job already knows all of that. He goes into trying to show the greatness of God over man. In verses 4 through 6, there's a verse in there that many use as a proof text for the false doctrine of original sin or inherited sin. Remember, these men are not inspired. This book is inspired of God to be in the Bible, but these men are not inspired of God. And so they say some things that are contradictory to other portions of the scripture. I could talk about that for a while, and I have a slide on that, but we don't have time. Man's frailty and God's majesty is talked about in chapter 26. 10 minutes. Job introduces this, his final response to the friends, if you will, with a statement that Bildad's attempts to provide comfort to him had been useless. Then in the remainder of the chapter, Job goes beyond Bildad's thoughts on the greatness of God. Look at verses 7 and 8 in chapter 26. Many have offered these statements of God as evidence that he's an inspired writer in this book. There are a couple of explanations as to how Job may have been aware of these facts by revelation or by observation, I think is the way he came by it, rather than inspiration. He could have seen that the earth was hung upon nothing by looking at the horizon, possibly, and seeing nothing there holding it up, no supports of any kind. He could have seen the moon and seen there's nothing there. It's just there in the middle of space with nothing holding it. So he could have seen it. It was a patriarchal age. God dealt with the heads of families. Maybe God told him something like that. But still, it's sort of amazing to us. We know he's not inspired. If you look at Job 38, 1 and 2, God asked Job a question, "Who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge?" And in Job 42, 3, Job makes a confession. He says, "Therefore I've uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me which I did not know." And then the last verse of that chapter 26, these are the mere edges or the outskirts, he says. Verse 14, the fringes of God's ways, and how small a whisper we hear of him, but the thunder of his power, who can understand? The omnipotence of God can scarcely be understood by man. God's in complete control of all that man knows of existence. Used to be an old man at the nursing home that would cry every time he sung the song, "There's an all-seeing eye watching you." He would cry all the way through the song from the start to the finish, and even afterwards. There's an all-seeing eye watching us. The omnipotence of God, His great power and His great knowledge, all of the things that He possesses. God's eyes are even upon the people who have passed from this life. Even the wicked cannot escape His view. Chapter 27. Job makes a couple of comments here that are certainly important. Verses 2 through 6. He said, as God lives, it seems that he's making an oath here as he continues to maintain his innocence. He believes that it would that he's been denied justice, but he will not engage in lying by saying that he's wrong or tempting God to restore his fortunes by making a false statement, which would make him a hypocrite. He would remain confident in God and in the truth of his life that he is aware of, and he would keep a clear conscience no matter what his friends would say. I don't know what I did with that phone, but I've got 5 minutes left. I do know that much. Job seems to refer to his friends as enemies in verse 7. He's pronouncing a curse upon the wicked in verses 7 through 12 of chapter 27. Just as David often invoked the punishment of God upon his enemies in the Psalms, Job was calling upon God to vindicate him against his accusers. In God's sight, Job was right. His enemies were wrong. And Job had the right to ask the only one who can vindicate him against them. He's trying to get his friends to consider their position and plight. Should he be right and they be wrong? And we'll find out. We know the end of the story. We'll find out later. As Richard mentioned earlier, Job will be vindicated. Verses 17 through 23, he provides examples of the fate of the wicked. They're going to suffer punishment. We've touched on that already. Chapter 28. It shows that men will go to almost any lengths to obtain things that they deem to be precious. That's what this chapter, first part of this chapter, is about. And we could say a lot about that. You can't turn on TV these days without seeing somebody mining for gold or some kind of opals or some kind of precious gemstones all over the world. And men will try to obtain those things that are important to them. The conclusion of this chapter. Man cannot mine wisdom. Man cannot buy wisdom. Man cannot obtain wisdom through secular education with all its degrees and honors. You can't do it. The value of divine wisdom can't be purchased for silver or gold. Or anything else this earth has to offer. The verse 18 says the price of wisdom is above rubies. And so Price Billingsley was a preacher, a gospel preacher, an old-time gospel preacher, if you will. And he made this statement. He said, I will even say that the power of God's church in the world rests on education. The right kind of education. True education of our youth in the church is now our hope. But wrong educational ideas planted in the minds of our boys and girls can head us to destruction, he says. In speaking of this worldly, secular education, he goes on to say, I feel that everybody should have it just to know how little it's worth. Too often, colleges polish pebbles and dim diamonds. How we need the educated heart and brain in the church. Hearts supremely committed to the will of Christ. He made this statement that stuck with me. He said, as for my child, I should rather that he say ABCs in heaven than in hell he have all the educational honors of the world. We have this statement from Roy's Up. Fearing God and turning from evil may be summarized as adoration of God and obedience to God. Thus, the truly wise man is the one whose life is centered on God, not self, and is regulated by God. Man in right relationship with God, worshiping Him, serving Him, obeying Him, that is wisdom and understanding. Now, if you look back, you look at the last verse here in this chapter, which it'll take me a minute to get there. Somebody read that last verse, 28:28. All right, fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to turn away from evil is understanding. The point of chapter 28 is that Job is arguing that he's been a wise man, fearing God and hating evil all the time. He's been that way all the time. And if you don't believe it, look back at chapter 1 and verse 8. God said to Satan, in describing Job, that he was a man who fears God and shuns evil. Job had been a wise man all the time. He and God can certainly agree on that one point. We'll conclude with that thought. I went a minute and a half over. Please forgive me. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we're indeed grateful and thankful for the book of Job in your word. We're thankful, Father, that we can sit and study together, that we can learn great gems of knowledge which you've placed in your word for us to understand, that we might have wisdom that you intend for man to have, that we might realize that it's our whole duty to fear thee and keep thy commandments. Father, we ask thy blessings upon everyone here. We pray, Father, that you'll be with us through the continuance of the week. May we live with the kind of faith in thee and the trust in thee that we should have, that our lives may not only please thee, but would influence those around us for good. Bless each of us as we go our way. Keep us safe and watch over us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.